here this week. I recommend Dan Gilbert, Marty Seligman, Jonathan Haidt speaking right after, but I guarantee you nobody knows more about human nature and reads people better than Linda does. Now, I will try to be moderately brief. I've been to many Aspen Ideas Festivals. I know you didn't come to hear me. You came here to hear yourselves. I'll try not to get in the way of that. And it's a little odd talking about modesty in Aspen. I'm not really going to talk too much about my book, but in the book I do talk a little about people who live in Aspen who don't have a lot to be modest about. What I admire, if you go down and see them walking down the street at night downtown, is how incredibly beautiful and elegantly slender they are. They don't actually have thighs. They just have one elegant calf on top of the other. They've achieved sort of a genetic miracle. So all their grandmothers looked like Gertrude Stein, but by marrying beautiful people, all their granddaughters look like Uma Thurman. I don't know how they've done that. The nice thing about the moms is they all weigh less than their own children. During pregnancy, they've taken so many soy-based nutritional formulas, the babies come out, these 13-pound defensive linemen popping out there. The moms are flashing little Mandarin flashcards with little things, get them ready for the Harvard admissions process. Introduce them to their dogs. In Aspen, it's fashionable to have a dog a third as tall as your ceiling heights. So they got these gigantic hounds named after Jane Austen characters. And then the thing I wrote about in the book was the guys who are in their 80s here, and they've succeeded in business, and they've decided they're just not going to die. And so they get these personal trainers. They're popping Cialis like breath mints. You take a hike up the American Trail or one of the great trails around here. You see these guys, they've shrunk down to little 5-foot, 90-pound things covered in spandex. They just zoom by you, trailing little bits of contempt. It's like being passed by a little iron raisinette going up the hill. And so these people don't have much to be modest about, but nonetheless, that's what I'm going to talk about. And I'm going to start by talking about something that happened to me several months ago, which was I was driving home in D.C. At NPR, and I was listening to NPR, as one must. And we have a great program on NPR called The Big Broadcast on Sunday nights. And I happened to hear an episode of a show called Command Performance. And Command Performance was a variety show that went out to the troops in World War II. And the one I happened to hear was broadcast on VJ Day, 1945. In fact, it was broadcast live just hours after the Japanese announced their surrender. And all the big stars were on the show, Bob Hope, Marlene Dietrich, Frank Sinatra. The host was Bing Crosby. And he gets out there and he says, in the first moment of the show, we've just learned the Japanese have announced the surrender. But I guess we don't feel proud at this moment. We just feel humble. We're just glad we got through it. And this note of humility struck me very forcefully. And in the period of the show, they kept repeating it over and over again. In the middle of the show, Burgess Meredith, the actor, came out and read a passage from Ernie Pyle, the great war correspondent. And Pyle had written, "We won this war because we have brave soldiers, we have great allies, we happen to have material abundance. We didn't win it because we're God's chosen people or we're better than anybody else. We should just try to be worthy of the peace." And it was this note of modesty that really struck me. And so I get home and I turn on the TV and I turn on a football game, and there's a quarterback throws a pass, wide receiver catches it, 2-yard gain, cornerback, a defensive player, comes up and tackles him and does what all professional athletes do after moments of great personal achievement. He did a victory dance in honor of himself. And it occurred to me that this, I'd seen a bigger victory dance after a 2-yard gain than I just heard after the U.S. won World War II. And this seemed to me symptomatic of something, that there's been a shift from a culture of self-effacement that says, I'm no better than anybody else, but nobody's better than me, to a culture of self-expansion. And I really wanted to talk about that shift today. And I really want to try to say that this shift has undergirds a lot of the problems and a lot of the situations we have. And to describe this shift, let me go back to that time of around Command Performance and tell you a little historical story about people and the atmosphere in which they lived. And so if you go back to the president who was president then, Harry Truman, at the moment of that performance, if you go back to the man who was Supreme Commander, Dwight Eisenhower, think about how they were raised. They were raised in Independence, Missouri, Abilene, Texas, and there was a certain prevailing atmosphere in the way they were raised. Most of us actually wouldn't probably want to go back to those towns. They're pretty insular. They're probably racist. But they did have some qualities. They had an unproblematic embrace of virtues like hard work, being neat, being responsible. They did have tight communities, very interlocked in each other's lives. But they did also have an ethos of maxims that they were raised within. Maxims like, don't get too big for your britches, don't get above yourself. Truman remembered his neighbors as, quote, the salt of the earth. Truman was once described as a regular guy. His first boss, in fact, described him as a regular guy from the asshole outwards. And so being a regular guy, salt of the earth, not too big for your britches, a sort of social egalitarianism. Eisenhower was a very religious family, grew up in a religious family. They got down on their knees every night. And one night when he was very young, or one day when he was very young, on Halloween, he wanted to go out trick-or-treating. And his mom wouldn't let him because he was too young. And so he flew into just a tempestuous rage at, say, age 3 or 4. And he beat his hands against a tree until they were literally bloody. And his father ran out and shook him violently and said, get a grip on yourself, and sent him up to his room, where he cried in a rage for an hour. And finally, his mother came up to him, and she put lotion on his hands, and she put bandages around them. And she said to him, he that conquereth his own soul is greater than he who taketh a city. And when he was 76 years old, Eisenhower looked back and wrote that that was, quote, one of the most valuable moments of my life, he that conquereth his own soul. Now, Truman's family was a little less religious than Eisenhower, but pretty religious. And as a boy, he memorized a prayer, which he later said was one of the central prayers of his life, which he would repeat again and again in whatever circumstance he found it in. And here's a passage from the prayer that Truman memorized. Make me truthful, honest, and honorable in all things. Make me intellectually honest. Give me the ability to be charitable, forgiving, and patient with my fellow men. Help me understand their motives and their shortcomings, even as thou understands mine. Now, underlying these two stories is a common worldview, which in highbrow form you'd call the Augustinian worldview, which is that we have sin within ourselves and we have to master the weaknesses that are inside. And in this view, pride is the worst of all the sins. Because what pride does, it estranges you from God, it makes you desire to be your own God, it weakens the resistance to your own weakness inside. And it makes it hard to tap the larger blessings of life, which probably come from outside yourself, from your family, your friends, your neighbors, and your creator. And in this view of pride, pride is not only egotism, thinking a lot of yourself. Pride is self-preoccupation, thinking a lot about yourself, for good or ill. And that was an important part of how they grew up, thinking pride was the worst of their sins. Reinhold Niebuhr also grew up in the Midwest at roughly the same time, who was a prominent thinker when Command Performance aired. He wrote, evil in its most developed form is always a good which imagines itself or pretends to be better than it is. Great suspicion of pride and thinking you're better than you are. That Niebuhr argued that pride is the foundation of all the other sins. It leads to self-righteousness, greed, and vanity. And so this was the Augustinian climate. It was the idea that you should never promote yourself or think too much about yourself. It was why when they were born, Truman and Eisenhower, presidential candidates still didn't campaign about themselves because they didn't want to be seen talking about themselves. It was why in that era we got self-effacing movie stars like Gary Cooper and Gregory Peck, Jimmy Stewart, Henry Fonda over the case of a couple decades. I remember covering George H.W. Bush's campaign in the first time he ran for president, and he called his mom, who's still alive, and asked, how am I doing? And she said, you're talking about yourself. And in a modern presidential campaign, that's all you do. But it offended her sensibility. And so that was an ethos. And it was not about doing nothing. If you go to the dictionary definition of humility, it's about having low self-esteem. This was not thinking about yourself, but balancing aspiration with a sense of your own weakness. There's a Jewish story which captures this balance. It's about a rabbi who keeps slips of paper, one in each pocket. The first slip reads, the world was created for me. The second slip reads, I am just dust and ashes. And it's balancing those two things. And I think the mid-20th century, they did a reasonably good job of balancing. at least in the prevailing winds of the culture. But there was a shift around that time. The first big shift, which I'm not really going to talk about, was a rise in individualism, thinking a lot about the individual. And this happened both in the 60s and 80s. We used to think the 60s and the 80s, the 60s about social liberation of the individual, the 80s about economic liberation of the individual, were opposite trends. They were really the same trend, but two different sides of it, liberation of the individual from the group. But the second shift, which I'll dwell on a little more, was really founded from psychologists like Carl Rogers and Eric Fromm. They looked at their patients, and they said, the problem is not too much pride. The problem is the opposite. The problem is self-loathing. My patients have low self-esteem. Well, they don't need to be reminded how modest they are. They need to be puffed up a little. My patients think they're pond scum. And so as one psychologist of the time wrote, all neurotic manifestations are incarnations of self-hate. This is a totally opposite worldview. And the central human problem is not pride, it's lack of self-love. The central problem is the undervalued self. And so they believed we should orient all our institutions to boost self-love and self-esteem. They believed that people are basically good inside, they just need to let that goodness come out by loving themselves. As Rogers wrote, the goal of therapy is to be the self which one truly is. And that is an entirely different worldview. And starting in the 1950s and building straight through the 1970s, this different view of human nature prevailed and reshaped all of our institutions. It changed psychological counseling, it changed the schools, it changed parenting, it changed religion as it became much more promoting self-love, it changed the whole culture. And so it wasn't only Rogers, there was the individualism. I think in the years since, there's been the influence of technology has probably expanded self-love and self-preoccupation, a whole group of things. But there has been this shift. And I believe it's a measurable shift. And so just some data to suggest there has been a shift in the way we think about ourselves. In 1950, the Gallup organization asked high school seniors, are you a very important person? And in 1950, 12% of high school seniors said, yes, I'm a very important person, 12%. They asked the same question again in 2006. This time it wasn't 12%, it was 80%. And so that's a shift. If you look at math scores, we used to score very well in math. Now we're down. People at this conference will tell you it's either 17 or 36. But if you ask Americans, are you really good at math? We have gone from the middle of the pack to number one. We are number one in the world in thinking we're really good at math. In 1962, in the academic literature, there were zero articles on self-esteem in the educational journals. By 1992, there were 2,500. In 1950, parents were asked, what's the most important trait you want in your kids? Then, as now, the number one answer is, I want them to think for themselves. The number two answer in 1950 was obedience. I want them to respect me. Obedience is now the bottom answer. And so that's a shift. And in years since, these trends have not abated. In fact, in the past 10 or 15 years, there's been an expansion in, if you call it narcissism or self-regard, in these studies. So for example, psychologists give tests to measure self-regard, and they ask people, do these statements apply to you? I like to be the center of attention. I'm a special person. I show off if I get a chance. I find it easy to manipulate people. And so we don't have these measures going all the way back to 1950, but we have them going back for about 20 years. And the last 20 years, if you took 93% of teenagers right now score above the median score in 1980. So another way of saying that is there's been an increase of 30% in the narcissism score over those decades, people who identify with those things. The children of the boomers are, in fact, according to these scores, more self-regarding than the boomers themselves, which is saying something. One-third of Americans say they are completely satisfied with themselves. We have a flurry of data to suggest how happy we are with ourselves. 96% of college professors believe they have above-average teaching skills. 50% of high school students believe they will attend law school, med school, or graduate school. Time magazine recently asked people, are you in the top 1% of earners? 19% of Americans are in the top 1% of earners. And 36% expect to be someday. Isn't this true? In this room, that's actually true. Paul Schumacher and Edward Russo gave tests to executives, asking them to how much they knew about their own industries. In the advertising industry, people, and then they said, here's a test, how confident were you you got the answers to the test correctly? In the advertising industry, people gave answers they thought were 90% correct. In fact, they got 60% of the answers wrong. The most egotistical industry is the computer industry. People in the computer industry thought they got 95% of the answers correct. In fact, they got 80% wrong. This is, by the way, a strongly gender-linked trait. Men drown at twice the rate as women because men have tremendous confidence in their ability to swim after they've been drinking. The other thing that's increased in addition to the self-regard is the obsession with fame. In 2006, 51% of 25-year-olds said that being famous was the most important life goal they could have. That's twice as many said being spiritual was the most important life goal. 43% of middle school girls said their goal was to become a celebrity's personal assistant. That's twice as many said they wanted to become president of Harvard. A study recently of college students said, would you rather be famous and receive praise or have sex? Large majorities would rather receive praise than have sex. I've been a little famous. I remember sex. Sex is better. We are, by the way, among the most egotistical countries on earth. The top five egotistical countries, according to these studies, are Serbia, Chile, Israel, and the U.S. The least egotistical are South Korea, Switzerland, Japan, Taiwan, and Morocco. Now, this is not all Carl Rogers and the psychologists. It's not all intellectuals. As I say, it's probably technology. It's probably the rise of individualism. It's probably musical trends. A recent study of music lyrics, pop music lyrics, suggests that in the 1980s, most of the music emphasized togetherness. Today, most of the music emphasizes how great I am. And if you listen to any rap song, any Pink song, any Kesha song, any Katy Perry song, you're familiar with the lyrics. We now had a scandal recently, which was a self-parody of narcissism, the Anthony Weiner scandal. He didn't even have a relationship with somebody. He just took pictures of himself and broadcast it out to his audience. And so there, I think there has been this shift. And I think this shift is responsible not only for how people think of themselves, but for some broader social problems. The first of these is attitudes towards spending. If you think very highly of yourself, if you have a large sense of self, you're going to spend money as befit your station. And so if you look at personal consumption over the course of the 20th century, it's basically flat at 60% of GDP until the 70s, when this kicks in and it shoots up to 70%. Personal debt as a percent of GDP is basically 45% decade after decade until the 70s, and it shoots up to 145%. Total debt, including mortgage debt and other financial debt, shoots up from about 160% to 350%. And so that's how we got the financial bubble. Second, passing debt onto future generations. If you have a small view of yourself, if you see yourself as part of a long chain of generations being connected over the decades, you feel a visceral horror of imposing burdens on the people who are next in the chain. And if you go back to the New Deal and look at FDR, he looked at the future generations, and they had a good reason to spend a lot of money, but they said, we can't impose debt on them. If you see yourself more as enlarged and lose a sense of how you fit into a chain of generations, you feel less moral horror about imposing burdens on future generations. I think that's happened. Third, attitudes toward risk. If you have tremendous confidence in your own intellectual abilities, then you're going to believe risk assessment models on Wall Street that tell you you can basically handle the risk of what you're investing in. Fourth, polarization. If you have a large sense of your own intellectual weakness, you know you need the people who disagree with you to balance out your own ignorance. If you think you have 100% of the truth, then those people are just in the way. And it's no accident that Rush Limbaugh or people like that, or are very polarizing figures, are also their whole humor style is based on large ego. And so that's another effect. And so I think the self-magnification is an underlying contributing cause, not the only cause, but a contributing cause to a lot of our social problems. and a contributing cause to a lot of personal problems. I had decided to talk about modesty several weeks ago. I saw the current issue of the Atlantic, which is about the problems with self-esteem. And that talks about the sense one gets from a lot of people who are very successful even, that their sense of their self is built on shaky foundations. Their sense of their self has not built up gradually through accomplishment, but is built up through grades or by other people's reactions to them. And so it's more fragile. And I think that's what that article gets at. So I've tried to describe so far a shift in the intellectual climate, which led to a shift in how we think about ourselves, the shift from the culture of self-effacement to the culture of self-expansion. And so it's a pervasive problem, a pervasive cultural shift. And the question becomes, how do you get out of it? Well, the first step, I think, is developing an accurate and better sense of who we actually are, what skills we actually have, what we actually deserve. We're in the middle of a cognitive revolution led by a lot of people who are here in this the Ideas Festival this year, which I think does give us a more accurate and, frankly, a more limited sense of our own abilities. The cognitive revolution, if you signed up, a lot of the things that have been discovered over the last 30 years about who we are by these neuroscientists, cognitive scientists, psychologists, they congregate around a group of things which should make us a little less impressed by ourselves. The first is that we're really not aware of most of what we do. I talk about this in my book. The human mind can take in 12 million pieces of information, of which it can be consciously aware of 40. And so a lot of the stuff that we're doing, we're not in charge of. It's happening. And some of the oddities of this, I mentioned the famous study that people named Dennis are disproportionately likely to become dentists. People named Lawrence are disproportionately likely to become lawyers because unconsciously we bias toward things that are familiar, which is why my daughter is named President of the United States Brooks. The other one I should mention in this context is that if you eat alone, you eat this much. If you eat with two other people, you eat on average 35% more. If you eat with seven or more other people, you eat 86% more. So we're all screwed here. And so we have impressive abilities, but a lot of them we're not really responsible for. They're happening unconsciously. And often we're very ill-informed about our true selves. Go to any of the 9 million Dan Gilbert panels this week, and he'll tell you about that. The second thing we've learned is that we have free will, but our free will is bounded. We inherit a river of knowledge, some of it formed by genes millions of years ago, some of it formed by our civilization, some of it formed by family, some of it formed by culture, and it shapes the way we see the world. It gives us ways of seeing the world, but we didn't create them, we just inherited them. And so every man in this room probably likes women with a 0.7 waist-hip ratio, and we didn't create that ratio, it's just genetically sort of in us for evolutionary reasons. Women, unfortunately, like men who are taller than themselves, though I did read a great study I mentioned in that book, that a guy who's 5'6" can get as many online date offers as a guy who's 6', so long as he makes $172,000 a year more. And so these are preferences and ways of seeing the world we didn't create, but they're in us. We have cultural things that are in us that we didn't create. We are just the lucky recipients of. One of my favorite cultural studies, somebody had the bright idea of looking at people as they had coffee around the world and seeing how often they reached across the table and touched their companion at the coffee table. And I'm going to get the numbers slightly wrong, but in Rio, I think they touched 180 times an hour. In Paris, 120 times an hour. In London, 0 times an hour. And so we have free will. We have the ability to choose certain things and certain other things, but it's bounded because so much of what we're inheriting channels our decisions unconsciously. Joshua Green of Harvard says it's like a camera. You have manual settings on most of your cameras, but you usually don't turn them on all the time. You rely on the automatic settings. And so we really shouldn't be pleased with most of our decisions because most of it is happening in ways we didn't control. And the third thing that I think the psychologists are cohering around is the idea that we do not have one self. Each of us has multiple selves. Inside the brain, there are dozens of different systems competing for primacy at any given time. There's the fat-loving self and the dieting self, the angry self, the happy self, the short-term self, the long-term self. We have many different personalities. Maurice Sendak got it exactly right in this, his story, The Wild Things. We have wild things inside. The thing he got wrong was in the book, Where the Wild Things Are, Max looks into the eyes of the wild things and tames the wild things. The movie gets it more accurately. In the movie, Max cannot tame the wild things. That's more accurate. So these three findings, that most of our thinking is conscious, unconscious, most of our influences come long before we're really aware, and that we have many different selves in ways we're rarely aware, suggest that Ayn Rand was wrong. We are not masters of our own ship, captains masterfully steering our boat through life. We have control, but it's bounded. We have abilities, but we're really not responsible for them. We're deeply interconnected, and we shouldn't be so pleased with our ability to control things. And so I think this is giving us a different, more accurate, and I think more humble sense of who we are and what we're capable of, and most importantly, how much we rely on other people. And so I think to rediscover a sense of humility, it's important to go back and find the models and the exemplars who did preach and practice a lifestyle that was more accurate about who they are. And in my life, I always keep a list of people who I think exemplify these traits, and a list of five impressive people in Washington, just so I can say, hey, Washington may stink, but there are these people here. And those people include people like Anthony Weiner. No, I'm just kidding. Those people include people like George Shultz, Robert Rubin, Bob Gates, Jim Lehrer. And for them, it's not about self. It's about doing the job that they were given. Jeff Goldberg's here had a great line in a column. It's about the execution of responsibility. And that's what humility looks like in real life. And over the course of the 20th century and over the course of all the centuries, they have been exemplars who have exemplified this style of being. And it doesn't come from just one layer. It comes from many different layers. The first and I think most traditional layer of emphasizing humility is the religious layer. Think of all the different religious experiences that encourage modesty and humility. There's the sense of quieting the self through meditation and prayer. There's the sense of reminding how small you are in the presence of the Almighty. Rick Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life, begins with the sentence, "It's not about you." There's a sense of awe one feels standing at a cathedral. There's a sense of gratitude one feels when you say a blessing before a meal. And there's a sense of an attitude of life that is oriented around surrender. C.S. Lewis, who was the most profound and acute observer of religious experience, wrote that the most profound religious experiences obliterate the self. They involve self-forgetting and surrender. Lewis writes in one of his books, "In deepest solitude, there is a road right out of the self, a commerce with which, by refusing to identify itself with any object of the senses or anything whereof we have biological or social needs or anything imagined or any state of our own minds, proclaims itself purely objective. The presence of God is so far outside ourselves that you surrender yourself to it." And so Lewis says it's only in self-forgetfulness that you experience religious experiences. He also added one very canny point. Lewis at one point wrote, "Do not imagine that if you meet a really humble man, he will be what most people call humble nowadays. He will not be a sort of greasy, smarmy person who is always telling you he is nobody. Probably all you will think about him is that he seemed a cheerful, intelligent chap who took a real interest in what you said to him. He will not be thinking of humility. He will not be thinking of himself at all." And so there is a sort of religious tradition that emphasizes humility. There's also a political tradition. When our founders created this country, they had a profound distrust of themselves, and they had a profound distrust of the American people and the American character. And because they had this distrust of themselves, they erected Republican institutions to stand between the popular will and what actually turned into law. They also had a sense of public-spiritedness. And what they meant by public-spiritedness is the opposite of what we mean by public-spiritedness. When we think of public-spiritedness, someone who's public-spirited, we think of someone who is signing petitions, getting passionate about causes, getting involved. When they thought about public-spiritedness, it was a person who curbed your passions, who moderated your own opinions in order to create agreement and social cohesion. So their exemplar of public-spiritedness was George Washington, who was always self-controlled and who went out of the room when people would talk about himself. And so they created these Republican institutions to stand between the way of ourselves and our laws. Over the past 30 years, I'd say we've eroded those Republican institutions, and we regard anything that stands between ourselves and the law as illegitimate. Now, I've gone on too long, but I just want to talk about one final sense of humility, source of humility. And this is a sense of how one plans one life. I wrote a column recently about after reading a bunch of commencement speeches. And the speeches were what you would expect from an era of self-expansion. The message of most of the speeches was follow your passion, find your joy, chart your own course, march to the beat of your own drummer. It was all about you. It was the litany of expressive individualism. And I don't mean to totally disregard this way of looking at the world. One of the people I admire most gave a great commencement speech 2 years ago about, which was really in this vein. It was a guy named Clay Christensen who gave a great, great speech at Harvard 2 years ago. And he told the story of himself. He graduated from Harvard, and he decided at age 24 or 22, he went off to Oxford, probably on a Rhodes, and he said, I'm going to spend the next year finding my purpose in life. And so every day while he was a Rhodes Scholar, he took an hour off to think and to read and to think about his purpose. And he argued, unless you find your purpose at an early age, 22 or 24, you'll waste a lot of time deviating from your purpose. You won't know how to serve it. You won't have a guiding star, something to navigate your life by. And Christensen is a very admirable and successful man, and for him, that method has worked. It's about who am I? What is my purpose? And it's about executing a plan. Now, I admire him immensely. I doubt there are too many 20-year-olds or 22-year-olds or 24-year-olds who can sit down and define their purpose. I doubt they know themselves or the world enough to know how their life will be lived. I doubt any 22 or 24-year-old actually exists as themselves. I think that self is only formed through the processes of the life. And you only find that process later on. And so as much as I respect Christensen's root, which was thinking about yourself, what is your purpose, I'd like to describe a different route to fulfillment, which is more in keeping with the humility ethos of the mid-20th century, which I started off talking about. And in that, this other way of thinking about it, you don't ask, what is my purpose in life? You ask, what is life asking of me? What is life summoning me to do? Now, this is not a question I invented. This is a question found in a very famous book by Viktor Frankl called Man's Search for Meaning. And Frankl grew up in Europe. He was, as a young student, he was imprisoned in a Nazi concentration camp. And being in a Nazi concentration camp was obviously not the life he would have chosen for himself. But life presented him with this set of problems. And so he realized life had called upon him to study human psychology in moments of extreme suffering. As he wrote, suffering had become a task on which we did not want to turn our backs. And so the question is not, what do you want from life, but what is life asking of you? What problems in front of you is life asking you to solve? And the question becomes not, what do I want, but what does the world want? The assumption is that you didn't enter the world and create the world. The assumption is the world has been here long before you got here. The world is a story in the middle or toward the end. A lot of it's been going on before you got there. And you're entering a story that's well underway in a landscape that is completely filled. And your job is to find your position in that story, in that landscape, not to imagine it's being created for yourself. And so Frankl had this way of conceptualizing life, which I think would have been more familiar with the humility ethos that I described early on. And I think it's that sense of the smaller self and seeing yourself in the larger that is really the core to getting back to that ethos. And as I say, none of us would like to go back to 1950. None of us would like to go back to that era when women had very limited means, when the races were segregated. But that ethos of humility is part of a long Augustinian tradition really is something we've lost to our detriment. And the message is that most of us are egotistical most of the time, concerned about ourselves most of the time, but it's nonetheless true that life only comes to a point when the self dissolves into some larger task, and the purpose of life is not to find yourself, it's to lose yourself. So thank you very much. We have a few minutes for narcissists to get up and talk. No. Unlike the narcissist of the last 40 minutes. I see one question back.
Thank you for another wonderful presentation. I read your op-ed 2-3 weeks ago, and you saying I'm starting to cover the 2012 campaign with great reluctance because what I think the issues are aren't going to be discussed in some of the narcissism you talked about today. I was curious, did you get any feedback from any of the candidates, any of the political advisors, whatever group you want, claiming that they actually were going to do some of the things that we know they're not?
I've never had candidates call me and say, you know, I was campaigning a certain way and governing a certain way, but I read your column and you're right. I should do it another way. So I didn't get that reaction. I can tell you from private conversations that most candidates know what the country needs. They know we probably need to raise taxes on a certain number of people. We certainly need to trim entitlements, including Medicare. But they are within institutions, within parties, and they don't have free rein. And so there are only certain things they can say. And what is troubling to me is the parties have become more rigidly impinging upon their free movement. And so a Republican really is locked into a no new taxes pledge. Democrats are really pretty locked into a Medicare protection pledge. And it's very hard to give themselves the free movement that most economists, if you got them together, liberal or conservative, could find. And so they're really stuck in these narrow alleyways. That's one of the reasons, by the way, I'm quite pessimistic about what's going to happen in the country over the next 3 weeks. I really think there's a chance that we'll have some, we won't cut a deal. There's a significant chance we won't cut a deal on the debt ceiling, that we will have some sort of either small-term or long-term crack-up, and it's a good time to get your money out of the markets. No, I don't give financial advice. But I think there is this tradition, and Tom Friedman is here, also has written about this, that we have this conservative party that believes in limited government to enhance freedom. We have a liberal party that believes in expanding government to enhance security and equality. There's this Hamiltonian party, which believes in limited but energetic government to enhance social mobility, which would cut things that go to healthcare and the elderly and spend more on the young and innovation, and that party can exist and doesn't exist, and a lot of people wish it did.
So I know that you work in Washington a lot. You know a lot of the politicians that you work with, and you talked a little bit earlier about George H.W. Bush being told that he shouldn't talk about himself so much on the campaign trail by his mom. But do you think it's possible that any of the folks who are in politics, national politics in the United States right now, could actually be humble in the way that you're talking about? Or is it a process that basically invites narcissists, and you need to be narcissistic to be able to succeed in that process? And if there are humble people, who are they?
Yeah. Well, I mentioned some, but you're right. The political process is a process that encourages it and demands it. Because what are you doing if you're in politics? You're talking about yourself all day. Every meeting is about yourself and how you're going to market yourself. Every strategy session, every ad, it's all about yourself. And now I think most politicians are in it for the right reasons. It's not that glamorous a life. They wouldn't do it unless they really cared. And yet, to get into that world, the one thing they have, they're incredibly adept social creatures in general. They have what I call logorrhea dementia, which is they talk so much they drive themselves insane. But they also get very close to you. They invade your personal space. They rub your cheeks. They need that personal love. Two quick stories. I tell one story. You're going to call them name dropping, but I call it reporting. Bill Clinton's story. I'm in a hotel lobby in Boston. Clinton comes out of an elevator, sees me, and starts praising me for a column I'd written, praising him, which he thought was particularly brilliant. And comes up. But as people see Bill Clinton in the lobby, he starts backing up because he wants to welcome them into our conversation. So he's just talking to me, but he's 80 feet away from me. And he just wants the audience. And the social skill, the other story I tell is about Mitt Romney. I was following him while he was campaigning up in New Hampshire the last election cycle, and he was campaigning with his five perfect sons, Bip, Chip, Rip, Skip, Lip, and Dip, and Rip. And he goes into a diner in New Hampshire. He introduces himself to each family at each table of the diner, asks what village in New Hampshire you're from, and then he tells them about the home he owns in their village. And then he goes around. But he meets like 40 people. And on the way out, he first names almost everybody he's just met. And that's the social connection, but it's the need for that worship. And then the final thing I'll say about this, the corrosive influence, they, in general, a lot of them are really admirable, and I respect them for doing this, but their lives are so oriented about going up and down. Their relationships are up and down to the people they need, the people working for them. A lot of them have no lateral relationships with equals who could tell them they're full of it. And so they hit middle age, and then they discover that they've reached a certain stature in their lives, but they're really lonely. And so they decide in middle age to reach out and cure their loneliness. And because their relationships have been all up and down in the course of their lives, they have very few social skills laterally to have real friendships. And so suddenly it's like, you know, being kissed by a Saint Bernard. They overdo it. They just don't know how to do anything. And I wrote a column, and I mentioned the sentence that a young woman will find her at a dinner party in Washington, and suddenly some senator's tongue will be in her ear. And a number of people said, yes, that's the way it is. And so if you look at the Wiener scandal, the Governor Sanford scandal, a lot of the scandals, Spitzer, it's from people who are in mid-career just desperately and clumsily and stupidly lunging out for some sort of connection. And that's another effect of the where it's all about you not having those lateral relationships. Anyway, I think we're out of time. Thank you very much.